embarrassing.
Hey, sweetheart, how'd you like to take a ride on a real bike?
She's 16!
Cartoon dads. Has there ever been a less appealing class of people? Now, there's been plenty of cartoon dads over the years, okay? Many shows have had them, but at the end of the day, they've always typically fallen into two categories. The incompetent father, who means well, often the butt of the joke, and the hardworking, stressed out, may need to take a chill pill variety, often the butt of the joke. But do you get what I mean? The animated father archetype is hard to subvert. Even the most legitimately clever shows struggle with overcoming the stereotype. Despite all those hardships, though, there are a few standout examples of animated fathers that break out of these chains. Bob Belcher from Bob's Burgers, Nigel Thornberry, who I swear to God is his own creature, I've never seen or heard anyone like this in my entire life, he's amazing. Greg Universe before his baggage, the list goes on. But out of all of these lovable dads, who deserves the crown? Who is the ultimate cartoon dad king? Who works the absolute hardest to support their children in every way possible? Who is actually there to listen? Now, you could probably point to any of these aforementioned dads and say they fit this bill, but there's one cartoon dad I've yet to mention that stands above the rest. One that's proven time and time again that he is the ultimate cartoon father. And if we're being honest with ourselves, it's Heinz Doofenshmirtz. I know, right? Were you expecting that? Haha, maybe that's the point, stupid. But this might throw you off guard a little bit, considering that he is technically a villain, sort of. The series changed a lot, but I'm being 100% honest here. Not only was Heinz able to come to terms with his own childhood trauma and completely change the direction of his life because of his daughter, all because he was willing to communicate with her. Tell me, what other cartoon dad has done that? Not only listen to their children, but read their advice and follow it as well. Not just the other way around. Heinz manages to actually treat his daughter as an equal in that regard. We've been binging some old Phineas and Ferb lately during quarantine, so we want to give Doof the respect he deserves alongside the series as a whole. So without further ado, guys, let me try to convince you that Doofensmhirtz is the best dad.
It all began on the day of my actual birth. Both of my parents failed to show up.
Heinz Doofensmhirtz is a troubled individual riddled with childhood trauma and a career that isn't exactly healthy or normal. A huge part of the character's identity is his cosmically tragic, low-key hilarious backstories. Born in Gimmelstump, alone in a hospital, as his parents didn't even put in the effort to show up to his own birth. If you're wondering how that's physically possible, just don't. There's no answer that will ever satisfy you. And it only gets wilder as he spent every following birthday alone, throwing parties for himself at a knockoff Chuck E. Cheese. Every birthday cake he's ever made, consumed by Dunkelberry bats. At one point, his family disowned him, wearing paper bags in public. He had to become a lawn gnome. He was replaced with a dog named Only Son. Lived with a family of ocelots at one point. His brother became the favorite. He lost Balloonie, went on awkward dates with Phineas's mom Linda. He had a divorce. All of this is no joke, only scratching the surface of the trauma Doofensmhirtz has been through. Literally, until we kind of meet him in the series, he's only exclusively taken L's. Poor man, give him a break. You would imagine he'd be rotten to the core in every single aspect. Yet Doof is an example of someone who's a better, stronger person because of what they endured. Instead of being influenced by the toxic behavior and horrid situations that never stopped kicking him while he was down, and thanks to the movie Across the Second Dimension, we know just how bad Doofensmhirtz would have turned out under much smaller conditions. Literally, he only lost a toy train and he became actually evil. That just shows how incredible this Doof is under even more pressure. It's insane. Now, I know what you're gonna say. Doofensmhirtz is an evil villain. Every episode, he's trying to do something bad. What are you talking about? You're an idiot. And yes, all of those things are true. I am an idiot. But I wanna say that even though Doofensmhirtz is a bad guy, doesn't mean he's a bad guy. You know what I mean? Let me redeem him a little bit. I could point to the fact that he literally stopped being a villain by the end of the series and decided to fight for good, or the fact that literally all of his plans were just to take over a small area of land, and none of them were violent or that threatening at all. But no, I will concede a little bit. Okay, he was a bad person, and to an extent he was influenced by his childhood, not as much as I think he could have been, but it still led him in the wrong path. But there's still plenty of examples in the series of Doofensmhirtz being an incredible person, and deep down, a truly genuine one. Spa Day had him head over heels for the cutest kitten ever, and he ended up giving the cat back to their proper owner. I couldn't even do that. That was a cute kitten, man. I would have kept it all to myself. Doofensmhirtz is one of the most kind-hearted antagonists you'll meet in fiction, often gunning to eliminate pet peeves and rarely actually endangering anybody but himself. Another assumption is that he'd be horrible to women, or at least bitter towards them, but we know he's actually not that bad of a date in his younger years, and his ex-wife Charlene doesn't have anything against him. She'll bust his balls a bit, but she divorced him simply because they wanted different things and didn't mesh that well. The straw that broke the camel's back was literally a sock puppet named named Mr. Tomato. But they're super civil, they communicate, and for a divorced couple, I think that's better than most. While Doof seems like a decent guy to hang around minus the whole tri-state agenda, the most telling component of his soul lies within his parenting skills. Real talk, it's easy for the effects of poor parenting to carry over into the next generation. Victims growing up treating their children in similar ways without even realizing it. It can become a nasty, vicious cycle. Yet in 1992, Heinz received what he considered the biggest blessing in his life, the birth of his daughter, his only child, Vanessa Doofenshmirtz. In spite of all of the suffering he endured, Heinz decided to start his biggest venture yet, focusing all of his energy, whenever possible, into being there for his daughter and providing her with as much support as possible. That's some real hero stuff. Heinz does his best to keep Vanessa involved with his life, viewing Evil Incorporated as a quote, family business, and often bringing Vanessa to work, which in itself is a subversion of the hardworking, stressed out dad trope, because he's never too busy with an innater to spend time with his daughter, instead wanting his innaters to be a fun learning experience with her. He may be practicing villainy, but he's trying to turn it into a bonding experience with his child. That's 8 levels of crazy. However, his dedication to involving her with his work can get excessive, such as the special Summer Belongs to You, when Heinz kidnaps Major Monogram, which yes is illegal, bringing him and thus his work to what was supposed to be a private vacation between father and daughter. He's not perfect. Kidnapping's illegal. But that just makes Doofenshmirtz human. Compensating for the lack of his family honoring his own birthday, Doof always went above and beyond to give her extravagant birthday parties, despite the fact that she was never that into them. She always viewed his parties for her as flops, but he never gave up, bouncing back with another party every year. The greatest demonstration of this is the episode, Dude, We're Getting the Band Back Together. Doofenshmirtz goes all out for Vanessa's 16th birthday. The man recruits his own sworn enemy, Perry the Platypus, to help with setting up the party, and then awkwardly straps Perry to a giant firecracker as the grand finale. But look at this layout. Giant presents and inflatable characters scattered about. Call up MTV for a revival, because this is a sweet 16, okay? The situation illustrates how precious Vanessa is to Doofenshmirtz and how much she wants to right the wrongs of his childhood, because the party ends up being way too kiddy for Vanessa's liking. But of course, he coddles her and goes way too overboard, overstepping his boundaries by projecting onto her with his desire to blow up a platypus, referring to him as our nemesis, and violating her privacy by going through her address book and inviting all of her friends. Of course, Vanessa is embarrassed and upset, but instead of getting angry or calling her ungrateful, most parents would immediately jump to comparing the parties they throw for their child to the ones they were given growing up, saying, "You have it so much better." But Doof is just bummed out, looking at the party as another failure. He does take out his anger on Perry, which isn't healthy, okay, but never once does he direct his negative feelings towards his daughter, and that's important. This remains consistent throughout the entire series. He may be a sociopath, but he's a good dad, okay? That's all I'm trying to say. Luckily, things work out as Doof's brawl with Perry results in the party setup being trashed, which brings a vibe that Vanessa's friends are down for. And Vanessa informs her friends that this is because of her dad. She had no part in how awesome it turned out, and she's appreciative of her father's work. Not to mention this entire time, Vanessa stayed, which is a big part of her character that matters. She's not one to just abandon her father when she's fed up with him. Granted, especially earlier on in the series, she'd tune him out and give him a hard time, which is displayed in Tree to Get Ready, in which she suggests that summer school would be more enjoyable than spending time with her father, which that can't possibly be true, okay? He may be crazy, but I would take crazy science experiments and sci-fi inventions over a Scantron, like, any day. At the end of the day, however, she recognizes his efforts and stays by his side. Another amazing example of Doof going above and beyond for his daughter, and Vanessa acknowledging this, is in season 2, specifically the episode Finding Mary MacGuffin. This is a good episode, it's gonna come up again later. At the age of 7, Vanessa had an intense desire for a Mary MacGuffin doll, and Doof granted her one 10 years later. Vanessa is impressed he remembered for that long, only for Doof to explain he never stopped looking for a decade straight. The doll was discontinued. He searched for a discontinued doll continuously for an entire decade, in an age where online shopping wasn't quite where it is today, you know what I mean? That's actually insane. Name one other cartoon father who puts in that much effort. Homer Simpson, huh? Look at yourself, you look goofy right now. Get those trash opinions out of here. But how does Vanessa actually feel about her father? Well, again, in the beginning of the series, she's a lot more apprehensive about being around him, often trying to bust him for all of his evil inventions to her mother, which was one of the first characters who sees Doofenshmirtz for who he really is, believing that no one can truly be evil. And Heinz doesn't meet the criteria for a villain anyways. Vanessa doesn't hate her father, despite being frequently embarrassed by him. She just wants him to do better. She doesn't want him to hurt people and become someone genuinely sinister, past the point of no return, and she doesn't want him to be the epitome of an embarrassing dad, though deep down she understands it comes from great intent. intentions and his own screwed up childhood. Over time, their relationship does improve though. She takes a greater interest in his inventions despite her moral opposition, and she even dabbles in a bit of her own villainy, refusing to give up the doll to a little girl after fighting with Candace. Another huge win for Doof in relation to his daughter comes in Summer Belongs to You, where after some hijinks, Doof makes up for his shortcomings by traveling halfway around the world as fast as possible to retrieve Vanessa in Paris, putting her before his work. After all she wanted was to spend time with him, a huge upgrade from where they stood prior. I don't know a lot of teenage girls that want to hang out with their dad, period. Vanessa isn't the only one who comes around and grows, though. The season 3 episode Skiddlywhiffers finds Doof supervising a camp trip for Vanessa and her friends, embarrassing her all throughout, being overbearing and protective. Eventually, Vanessa stands up to her father and expresses, although she understands, she's smothered. Now, this is an unhinged man who spends every day trying to take over the tri-state area, but instead of getting mad, like even remotely, Heinz actually listens, swearing to no longer be overprotective, and although he has his moments, he does legitimately back off in the following episodes, which in return, he sees a great improvement. That doesn't mean he won't get involved when necessary. The climax of Skiddlywhiffers features Vanessa and her friends approached by a swarm of bees, and whereas most of these cartoon dads would stay away, Heinz covers himself in honey and lures the bees into a lake as he dives off of a cliff into it. He could have died. Just keep that in mind. All in the name of protecting his daughter. Name a better king, I cannot. Season 3 really puts in the elbow grease to show how much their relationship improved and how much they influence one another. After Vanessa dumps Johnny in the episode Minor Monogram, which of course introduces Major Monogram's son Monty, Heinz ironically remarks that Vanessa needs to stop dating the bad boy type, going for the wrong crowd, and Vanessa confesses later that her inclination for bad boys is a result of her father's aspirations as a villain. She gets screwed over by Rodrigo, Doof's evil apprentice, who of course is more rotten than Doof, and finds herself attracted to Monty Monogram after he swoops in to save the day. The two go on a date, showcased in the episode Sipping with the Enemy. Agent P works with her to cover up the date, but Monty's disrespect towards Doof doesn't fly with Vanessa. She stands up for her dad and recognizes where he succeeds in his profession despite the incompetence. They continue to see each other through due to clicking in all other aspects and loving the thrill of secrecy, as shown in season 4 with the episode My Sweet Ride. The last piece of this family puzzle before the series finale arrives in season 4 with the episode Doof 101, where Doof is forced to become the new science teacher at Vanessa's school as community service. By the way, this is one of the few episodes to take place outside of summer. Doof mentions it in a small song, and it's incredible. It almost brings these two back to square one, Vanessa afraid of being embarrassed, while Doof views it as a great way to get a more father and daughter time. Long story short, Doof screws up and mutates Johnny, Vanessa's ex, but he manages to save the day with assistance from Perry. Vanessa, instead of being furious, ultimately settles on an optimistic approach, just requesting for her dad to not make mutations and insane experiments an everyday thing, which arguably it shouldn't be, because it's crazy. I really recommend watching this episode for yourself. It's the best way to see how much these characters have grown over the summer going into fall. Better than it can be to just put it into words, at least. But the biggest influence Vanessa had over Doof, the last thing that really puts a bow on Doof being the greatest cartoon dad, is the finale, Last Day of Summer. At first, Heinz and Vanessa have the biggest wedge between them. For the first time, Doof is too busy to communicate with Vanessa, and she eventually is able to reveal the information that she's moving in with her mother permanently. That's tough. Doof blames himself for being a lame villain, but Vanessa establishes it's because he's a villain that she's moving out, because she's achieved an internship at OWCA and can't live with her top number 3 enemy. This coincides with Doof's biggest scheme to conquer the tri-state area. After realizing such a position doesn't actually exist, he invents the tri-governorinator, which would make him tri-governor of the tri-state area and thus able to rule it. This is alongside the do-overinator, which allows Doof to restart the day whenever he desires, although it just happens to be the last day of summer, and then timelines get meddled, people start disappearing, it's an entire ordeal, but in between dealing with that, Doof finally gets to rule the tri-state area and feels underwhelmed. This causes Vanessa to bring everything full circle and call out that his occupation only exists because of his crummy childhood, and he's not an evil person, rather a good guy pretending to be evil because it feels like he has to be. Society should have completely jokered up Heinz, but that's just not who he is at his core. Again, I point to another version of him from across the second dimension, where he literally is a threatening supervillain. Look at that scar, look at that eye patch, it's scary. All because he lost a toy train. Way less of a reason. That's 1/1000th of the trauma that Heinz has been through, and despite all of it, he never turned into a real villain. So after his ultimate failure and achieving his dream, he tries to be a good guy, saving reality as a whole. Then he realizes he's not that great at being a good guy either. He needs direction. He's brave enough to be vulnerable and admit that not just to his daughter, but himself. Vanessa points him in that direction, OWCA, leading him into the OWCA file special, but that's a video for another time. But that ultimately completed Doofenshmirtz's entire arc for the series. His entire arc, from villain to good guy, was accompanied by his developing relationship with his daughter, one that stayed healthy the whole time throughout many hardships. And in the end, it was his relationship with his daughter that ended up saving him from his biggest problem, his villainy. Throughout the series, Heinz was a good, caring communicator. He listened to his daughter and respected her wishes, which are all good qualities of the best cartoon dad. And in the end, it was his good fathering skills that turned his whole life around. There's been a lot of good cartoon dads, okay? I'm not gonna say there isn't. But I've never seen a cartoon dad like Heinz Doofenshmirtz, who manages to break all of the bonds and tell an actual realistic story between father and daughter in a divorced relationship. It's all at once hopeful and wholesome and hard, and that's what fatherhood is. Represented by this guy with his goofy ass head. Doofenshmirtz may be a bad villain, but he's not a bad dad. And that's where I'll leave it. Hopefully, I convinced you, but if I didn't, I don't know what else to do. You're just too stubborn. I hate you. But as always, I want to know what you guys think about all of this. Okay, do you think this is legit? Or do you think he's a sociopath? Those are all valid. Let us know in those comments down below. Tweet to us at Roundtable Vids or me at Stretcher Nemo. If you want to consider helping out the Roundtable, you can become a member of the channel or support us on Patreon and get exclusive access to scripts and avatars. As always, if you enjoyed this video, make sure to give it a like, share it, and subscribe to the Roundtable for more incredible cartoon content. As always, guys, I'm Nemo. This is a Phineas and Ferb video, and I will see you next time. Peace.